Alexis Conran on Times Radio.
Every week on this show, we do our bit to show you that politics isn't quite as polarised as the headlines might sometimes suggest. And we do that by introducing you to two political frenemies. That's politicians from across the political divide who actually get on with one another and have worked together sometimes for the common good. But they're actually calling each other friends. Now, this week, I'm delighted to be joined by John Penrose, Conservative MP since 2005, who is also a former Northern Ireland minister and former anti-corruption champion at the Home Office. John, good afternoon. Welcome.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for joining us, John, alongside your political frenemy, Stephen Kinnock, Labour MP since 2015 and current Shadow Minister for Immigration. Stephen, good afternoon to you.
Hello, Alexis. Good afternoon. And hi, John.
Thank you for joining me both. Look, I'm going to ask you the same question I've been asking the listeners before we kick off about your friendship. But do either of you have a particular Paul McCartney or Beatles song that is, we're celebrating his 80th birthday today. What's the song that that sticks out for you in his body of work, that huge body of work, John?
Mine would be Get Back.
Oh, yes.
I saw a video of him once when he was in the studio putting it together when it first appeared out of his head and out of his guitar. Absolutely extraordinary sort of 90-second clip of him doing the creation of that song.
It is incredible. It's part of that Peter Jackson documentary. You kind of, you're seeing the birth of a classic, and it's sort of, it's almost there, and you're like, oh, I recognise this bit, and it's a fantastic clip. You're absolutely right. Stephen, any particular favourites?
I think my favourite Beatles song is Twist and Shout. I just think it's a great song to get down on the dance floor and have some good times. So, yeah, I think Twist and Shout would be my favourite.
A favourite one at the Labour Party conference? Is that what gets everyone dancing?
Yeah, but I stay away from the karaoke machine. That is not a vote winner.
I know, with so many cameras around, I'm amazed that people are willing to risk that. Now, look, let's talk about you two. John, we asked you to come on the show, and we said, who is going to be your political frenemy? And you nominated Stephen. So why did you nominate Stephen?
I'm sorry to dob Stephen in it. I've probably ruined his political career. And but, I mean, the thing which we're doing at the moment, we sort of knock around, everyone knocks around Westminster all the time. The thing that Steve and I are doing at the moment is we're both on an advisory board for a think tank called the John Mills Institute for Prosperity. And even when Steve and I don't particularly agree on everything on that, we're both trying to sort of achieve the same things. And actually, I found myself agreeing with quite a lot of what he said. I hope you might even have felt the same about me on occasions throughout as well. But we're both trying to work towards the same end, which is mainly about trying to improve British manufacturing and sort of assist in a rebirth of British manufacturing. So we're on the same page.
Stephen, when was the first time that you met John? Do you remember when you first connected together and thought, you know what, there's yes, we belong to different parties, but we can actually do some good here?
I do remember. I think it was actually we ended up having quite a geeky conversation about sovereign wealth funds. And
my goodness.
John and I share...
Oh, God, the shame. You're right.
Those winter hours must fly by.
Exactly. We really know how to live in Westminster, you know. We really do. We had a... I can't quite remember what triggered it, but we ended up having a long chat and a coffee talking specifically about sovereign wealth funds. We have a passion for sovereign wealth funds. Think it's a huge missed opportunity. The United Kingdom never built one, could have built one off the back of North Sea oil and gas, of course, and failed to do so. And when you look at countries around the world that have built sovereign wealth funds, not least Norway, it's had huge benefits for investment and for jobs and for creating that sense of kind of long-term certainty in the economy. So, sovereign wealth funds first. And then we worked around electoral campaigning transparency. I chair an all-party parliamentary group, and it's great to have John as the vice chair of that, trying really to kind of clean up British politics and deal with some of the issues around donations. And then, as John absolutely rightly says, on manufacturing, we have a shared passion for driving a modern manufacturing renaissance in the UK. So loads of different shared interests. Probably on the we're on the geeky spectrum. There's no doubt about that. Policy want spectrum. We're proud of it. We're proud to be there.
John, do you think that there are actually more people like yourself and Stephen in Parliament than we, the general public, end up perceiving? Because, to be fair, most people who don't take an active interest in politics will watch PMQs, they might watch some clips on the 10 o'clock news, and all we're seeing is people facing off against each other, being very angry at each other. And we tend to sort of miss the stories of people like yourself sort of actually coming together and working together. Do you think that actually we need to see a bit more of that?
Yeah, I think it's a great deal more common than, as you say, what appears on the news, because the conflict is the bit that sort of makes good news clips, isn't it? But there's an awful lot more of the mutual respect and working together than you'd otherwise expect. I mean, most obviously, most select committees, which are these sort of scrutiny committees that Parliament creates, they're all cross-party. And after you've been on a select committee working with people from the Labour Party and the SNP and whoever, for a year or two, you often count them as, if not sort of close friends, at least people who you like and admire and often respect, just because they've probably got into politics for the same reason you did, even if they choose different ways to take it forward.
Stephen, what's the current climate in Parliament? Of course, you know, the Brexit years, of course, were very, very divisive. I believe that you and John were on the same side of the Brexit argument. You were both against Brexit, but accepted the result and moved forward to see how it can best be delivered. So I don't want to revisit that era, but it seems like we sort of calmed down, then we had the pandemic, but now we've got more to worry about. Things like Partygate, the cost of living, refugee crisis. What's the atmosphere now in the House, particularly amongst people like yourselves who are friends, but you're in opposite parties?
There are sort of two parallel universes, I think, in the House. There is, as on one side, as John absolutely rightly said, there are areas where colleagues work together across parties, the select committees being the best example of that. And then there's the other universe, which tends to be more in the chamber, and particularly the big set piece events like Prime Minister's Questions, where it's all about wedge issues. It's all about showing dividing lines and people getting lots of huffing and puffing in the chamber and people getting very wound up. And that is a reminiscent of the Brexit era, which and that tended to dominate. But I'm always very struck by the way in which you kind of go into the chamber. It is a bit of a gladiatorial arena. The gladiatorial stuff takes place and we leave the chamber and we go back much more into a normal discourse. So there is a sort of, we do recognise that there's an element of theatre in Parliament and there's an element of, well, you're going to get your 30-second clip on the BBC News and that's the chamber and that's kind of the way it is. I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing for democracy, because we do have to show that we're passionate and we really believe, and there's certain things where we do take very, very different positions on issues, like the Northern Ireland Protocol, like the Rwanda Plan. And you know, I think that's a good thing, because we need to show that clarity to the British people that there are really two clear choices here. But then underneath that, you've got to also be pragmatic and find ways of working. So I always describe it as two parallel universes, really, and you kind of got to be able to shift from one to the other.
Well, we're going to talk a little bit about both those issues, the Rwandan asylum policy and the Northern Ireland Protocol. John, another divisive figure, let's put it that way, of course, is the Prime Minister, Boris Johnson. And you wrote a staggering letter 2 weeks ago. In your resignation letter, you were very candid, very open about why you couldn't support the Prime Minister. Do you think that Boris Johnson has made it harder for MPs such as yourself and Stephen to get together, for members across the House, and work together? And how difficult was that letter for you to write and publicise?
The letter was pretty difficult. I mean, it's something which took me, it was not an easy decision, not a comfortable decision. And yeah, anybody who's ever had to do anything like that in any walk of life will know you think about it quite a lot and you sort of, you work up to it. So, and I guess I was no different about that. I don't think, though, that the current set of problems over things like Partygate are making it harder for your sort of political frenemies sort of idea to happen in Parliament. I think it's still happening. I mean, I think Stephen's right about there being two parallel worlds going on in Parliament all the time. It's kind of like front row forwards. You know, they may knock seven bells out of each other on the pitch on two opposing two opposing sides, and then they'll all buy each other a beer in the bar afterwards. And it's kind of that sort of feel to it, I think.
Okay. Well, look, let's see if we can maintain that feel, and you guys can still buy each other a round after we finished for the next half hour. Plenty to discuss. Stay where you are, both of you, but we'll come back after we get the latest half-hour headlines and sport with Rachel Jewell. Still with me are my two political frenemies, staying with me for the next half an hour or so to chew over some of the big political stories of the week. They are John Penrose, Conservative MP for Weston-super-Mare and former Northern Ireland Minister, and Stephen Kinnock, a Labour MP for Aberavon and Shadow Minister for Immigration. Gentlemen, let's start with the big story at the moment, which is the Rwanda and the refugee policies that the government have been announcing today. Flights being cancelled has been a big feature of the week, but one particular plane has, of course, been the main subject of attention. The private charter flight, which is estimated to have cost taxpayers about £500,000, which was supposed to carry the first asylum seekers to Rwanda. Now, the flight was halted minutes before its scheduled takeoff on Tuesday after the ECHR ruled that two of the people due to be on board should be removed from the UK until their appeals had been heard. Now, it's fair to say Home Secretary Priti Patel wasn't best pleased.
While this decision by the Strasbourg court to intervene was disappointing and surprising, given the repeated and considered judgments to the contrary in our domestic courts, we remain committed to this policy.
And in an interview with The Telegraph today, the Home Secretary Priti Patel describes the European Court of Human Rights as opaque and says its decision was scandalous and politically motivated. The Spectator also reports a source close to the government thinking was saying that they never expected the flight to take off. The point of the exercise was to create dividing lines ahead of the next general election, which is going to be fought in part on a manifesto to pledge to leave the European Court of Human Rights and repeal the Human Rights Act. John, I'm going to start with you first, because I know that Stephen, being the Shadow Minister for Immigration, is going to have a lot to say, but I'm sure you're going to have a lot to say. It's been very interesting that during your beginning, when we were talking, we've had a text message saying, how is it possible to be friends with someone who supports the Rwandan policy? It couldn't be. So I guess we're going to put some friendships to the test here. But John, what do you make of this Rwandan asylum seeker policy and the latest news that we heard about the plans to tag asylum seekers that come into the country?
Well, I think I'd start by saying that this point about this unnamed source, this person who won't put their name to it, saying it's never expected to take off or never supposed to take off, and it's just designed to create dividing lines. I mean, I think that if it sounds very, very short-sighted, because we came into government pledging to take back control of our borders. And while we've been able to do that for legal arrivals on things like we've now got this points-based immigration system, we've got people coming to this country now under a controlled basis from all the way around the world, not just in and out of Europe, but from all different parts of the world. That's fine, because it's something where we're choosing who to let in and who not to. But the bit that's still outstanding from that, the bit that people are still saying, hang on, you promised to take control of our borders and you haven't yet completed that job, is the people who are turning up on small dinghies and small boats across the channel. And so I don't think it's going to be enough for us to be able to say, here's something which is an election manifesto for whenever the next election might be in 2 years' time. I think we've got to have shown tangible, concrete results rather than just planes that haven't taken off yet, well before then. So I think that we've got to solve this. And I guess the difficulty which I and many others face is if you're not going to do the Rwandan approach or some close cousin of it, and I do appreciate there are honestly held, legitimate opposing views to this. I'm sure Stephen will explain why he's one of them in a minute. But if it's not that, then you've got to come up with something which is going to work instead. And at the moment, all the alternatives that I hear basically involve saying we'll just let everybody in. I mean, they say it slightly more.
I think people are.
That's the problem, which I think we're all facing.
Sure, but I think people have been making rather more succinct suggestions and more nuanced suggestions of opening up routes that we've closed since the government took office. That at the moment, all the routes that were available for people to seek asylum, or many of them, have been shut down. So it's not as if people don't have any other solutions. But look, the expert on this is going to be Stephen Kinnock. So Stephen Kinnock, what are your thoughts?
Well, we agree entirely that we need to stop people taking this very dangerous journey across the channel on small boats. But this Rwanda policy is just not the way to do it. It will not act as a deterrent because, well, there's very limited capacity in Rwanda for starters as to how many asylum seekers they can actually take down there. You know, last year we had 28,000 crossing the channel in small boats, so a tiny proportion might go to Rwanda. I'm afraid I was in Calais just recently talking to people in the camps, and they were very clear. They knew about the Rwanda plan. It was in no way going to change their plans to try to come across, in that case, actually on lorries. So I'm also just gobsmacked by the cost of it. I mean, that flight that didn't take off, that was £500,000 worth. They've already given £120 million to the Rwandan government. What are we getting? What are British taxpayers getting for that money at this in the middle of this cost of living crisis? And it also just feels profoundly wrong and un-British to me that we offload a challenge that we're facing alongside many, many other countries. And of course, Germany and Italy and France have many more asylum seekers than we do. We offload it onto a developing country thousands of miles away, which itself has a dubious human rights record. I mean, in 2018, 12 asylum seekers were shot dead by the Rwandan authorities protesting over food shortages. So I think on many, many levels, it's the wrong policy. We agree on the objective that we want to achieve, but this is not the way
to
go about it.
But listening to John, If you're objecting to this policy, what would Labour do differently? How do you solve the problem of reducing the number of people that come in by and not using anything like the Rwanda asylum policy?
So a three-point plan. Open up the safe and legal routes. The vast majority are coming from countries like Afghanistan, Syria. They need to be clarified as countries where safe and legal routes are available. An application should then be made in a country near to the country that they're leaving. So we need much better international cooperation to make that happen. We need a grown-up conversation with the French. When we left the European Union, we also left the Dublin regulation. The Prime Minister's botched Brexit deal, I'm afraid, made no attempt to negotiate a successor for Dublin, and that has led to the problem we have that then since 2018 we've seen this serious uptick in the numbers coming across. And then we need a proper security partnership working with Europol and the French to crack down on the criminal gangs, crack down on the way in which these small boats are being procured. A proper licensing scheme, for example, would be a very good way of stopping that business model from functioning. Okay. So it's a three-point plan.
Okay. I just wanted to get just a very quick thought, because I'm going to move on to Northern Ireland in a second. Just a very quick thought from both of you of the latest story that we heard today, which is the idea of fitting asylum seekers with ankle bracelets, tagging devices. John, it seems like if someone is escaping a war-torn country, is got through all they've got through to get here, the fact that we then go, do you know what, we're not going to give you asylum here, and because we're worried that you might abscond and disappear into the system, we're going to give you an ankle bracelet. It seems that we're treating people as criminals the moment they get here. What are your thoughts of the tagging proposals, this trial that's been proposed by the Home Office? It started on Thursday. It's going to go on for 12 months.
I draw a big distinction, I think it was inherent in your question, between people who've arrived through legal routes, of which there are plenty, I take Stephen's point about us needing to revisit some of the Syria schemes, for example, which have been very successful in the past as well. But there are plenty still in the system because we haven't processed a lot of them already, and we should have done. So we need to process them faster. But if they've arrived here under legal routes, then I don't think tagging is appropriate. But for the ones who've arrived here illegally, and where there is a a risk that they'll try and disappear, then you've got to take a view about, well, how big is that risk for each case? Because otherwise, you can have all the schemes, whether you approve of the Rwanda scheme or you approve of Stephen's three-point plan, whatever approach you take, the danger always in a country like ours, which doesn't have ID cards and doesn't believe in them, is that people can just disappear if you're not careful. So if there is a flight risk, I don't think that any scheme is going to have very much credibility.
Okay.
You can't keep track of the ones who might do a runner.
Okay. Stephen, a word on that?
Yeah, I mean, around about 85% are in most of the groups that come to the country from certain countries are approved as valid asylum seekers. They go through the application process. There's Home Office decision makers. So the vast majority of people who do come are fleeing violence and persecution. And it just doesn't feel right to me that we put an electronic tagging device on somebody that is fleeing war, violence and persecution, will have been through an extremely traumatic experience, often victims of torture and trafficking. Electronic tagging will always be associated with criminals and with criminal behavior. And I just feel that we would be demonizing these people if we were to go down that path.
Okay.
I think it's the wrong thing to do. The thing to do, as John absolutely rightly said, is to speed up the processing. I mean, we currently have 37,000 asylum seekers languishing in hotels, costing the taxpayer £4 million a day. Let's focus on getting that sorted before looking at any of these other issues, which feel a little bit just like chasing headlines.
Okay, I want to move to Northern Ireland now. Plans by the government to scrap parts of the Northern Ireland Protocol are absolutely reckless, as the Deputy Leader Michelle O'Neill has said, the Deputy Leader of Sinn Féin, of course. The UK government says it wants to change parts of the protocol to make it easier for some goods to flow from Great Britain to Northern Ireland, but the EU is against the move, saying it would break international law. It's a whole rewrite of the protocol, effectively ending the Northern Ireland rules of staying in the single market, essentially. John, as a former Northern Ireland minister, a question that many people have asked, and it is curious, that why not trigger the built-in mechanism of the Northern Ireland Protocol, the so-called Article 16, by triggering Article 16, then you basically alert that there is a problem with the protocol, and that is its inbuilt mechanism, if you like, of taking care of any problems. At the moment, the government is going down the doctrine of necessity, which basically says, look, there is absolutely no other avenue, no other course that we can take other than to just break this treaty. However, that's exactly what Article 16 is there for, which means that it seems a bit disingenuous to go down the route of the doctrine of necessity.
So I'm not involved. I haven't been Northern Ireland Minister for just over 2 years now, so I haven't been involved in the most recent discussions. But I think that if you had one of my successors on this call now, I think what they'd be saying is, look, they would say we really have been very closely involved with discussions with both the Republic of Ireland's government and also with Mr. Sefcovic and others in the EU Commission, trying to make this work and trying to make this work within the existing system, because there's a whole series of protocol-based committees designed to broker and sort out disagreements just like this one. And the trouble with it is that just ain't working. And I suspect that probably at that point, the decision about whether or not you go down the Article 16 route or the Doctrine of Necessity route, which you just described, is probably based on legal advice about which one's going to work best and that sort of stuff. The odd thing about all of this, of course, is that the one thing that most sides seem to be agreed on is that if you can make a green lane and yellow lane system work, which is what everyone seems to be proposing is a sensible way of doing it. So stuff that goes between mainland GB and Republic and Northern Ireland just goes through a green lane. Anything that's going on through Northern Ireland into the Republic of Ireland goes through a red lane, and that's how you handle it in practice, in practical terms. Everyone seems to agree that's actually probably 90% of the answer, and why don't we get on with it? So it seems like one of these things where the legal form, important though it is kind of overshadowing the practicalities, because it looks like there's a system, a solution which might well work, sitting somewhere in the middle of the table.
Stephen, Article 16 has been left alone. We're going down the route of doctrine of necessity. I mean, as John said there, you know, that is the legal cover that the government is using. Does it wash with you?
Well, I think so much of international relations is about trust, isn't it? Well, I mean, you can have all the treaties and protocols that you like, but you do also need to have a basic level of trust, a duty of sincere cooperation, as I think it's called in the EU jargon. And the fundamental problem here is that nobody trusts the Prime Minister. So if you don't have that basic trust, then green lanes and red lanes and amber lanes are not really going to work, because people feel that that's all going to be undermined and walked away from. I mean, we've got a Prime Minister here who signed an international treaty and then just a very short time later is looking to break it, sort of saber-rattling about leaving the European Court of Human Rights. And I think that because all of the bridges have been burned with the European Union, it's very difficult to rebuild that trust and to imagine grown-up and serious negotiations happening with this Prime Minister. What we've been saying is we need to have a deal on sanitary and phytosanitary checks, which would remove 80 to 90% of the Northern Ireland Protocol issues, because so many of those are about agri-foods. I think that we also just need to see people stepping back and being more flexible. We've said that the European Union should be more flexible as well, but of course you can see that the barriers come up because the trust is breaking down. So it is quite difficult to see how we get around this without things leading to possibly to escalation. And I think that's the biggest worry of all, is that we could end up with the entire trade and cooperation agreement with the EU being suspended and a trade war with the EU in the middle of a cost of living crisis, the last thing the country needs.
Yeah, nobody really wants to see that. Okay, stay where you are, both of you. We've got a few more stories to get through. We've got about 9 minutes left, so we're going to try and squeeze them in. It is 9 minutes to two. You're listening to Alexis Conran here on Times Radio.
Times Radio with Alexis Conran.
My two political frenemies are still with me for about 7 minutes or so, Conservative MP John Penrose and Labour MP Stephen Kinnock. They're going to be giving me their heroes and villains of the week in a moment, and you can too by texting into the show, 87222, start your message with the word Times, or you could tweet us here at Times Radio. Now, I just want to talk a little bit about another big story this week, which is Lord Guyot's resignation. Boris Johnson's former ethics advisor has said that he resigned from his role this week over the government's openness to breaking international law. In a second letter outlining why he had quit, Lord Guyot said reports it was related to steel tariffs were a distraction. I could not be a party to advising on any political law breaking, he said. Lord Guyot is now the second ethics advisor to quit under Mr. Johnson after Sir Alex Allen left back in 2020. John, we are now talking about whether or not Lord Guyot is going to be replaced, who he's going to be replaced by, how soon he's going to be replaced. But my question is slightly different. Is it time, or does it make more sense that the Prime Minister is not the sole arbiter of the ministerial code, and a position like Lord Guyot's is actually a purely independent position, a purely independent body that can launch its own investigations, put its findings to Parliament, and let Parliament decide?
Well, so actually that's what the new role which Lord Guyot had just negotiated himself does most of. I mean, there's a few details in there which are slightly different from that, but he had actually successfully got himself quite a lot of new powers. There are a couple of other things that I think his successor will need as well, which we've only just spotted as problems as a result of what's been going on here. But I just think the most important thing here is we've got to get a successor in place. They already have the ability to ask publicly to initiate their own investigations. And I think it's very hard to see how any Prime Minister will be able to turn them down for anything that's even vaguely legitimate without completely, you know, self-combusting in the process. But we just got to get somebody who is, you know, rock-ribbed independent in that position pretty quickly. And then we've got to make sure that the Prime Minister isn't exempt from the process. The problem, which I think has happened over the course of the last couple of weeks, is that any minister at the moment can be reported on by Lord Guyot or his successor, except for the Prime Minister. And that clearly doesn't make sense. That's clearly silly. There shouldn't be a sort of get out of jail free card for any prime minister now or in future. So we need to make sure that that exemption is removed, and then we'll have a proper independent report from Lord Guyot or Lord Guyot's successors to be put in front of Parliament, and Parliament can then take a view if any future prime minister is found to have been playing fast and loose with the ministerial code. But that's what's got to happen. It's going to happen soon.
Stephen, has the problem been the fact that Parliament's set up to work on trust, it works on convention, it works on almost an honour system where you're expecting people to do the honourable thing and step down, for example, if they've found to have broken the ministerial code, but we're dealing with an administration that it doesn't really abide with those rules because it doesn't really have to. It doesn't say anywhere that if you've broken the ministerial code, you have to resign. It's down to the Prime Minister's discretion, and therefore that's what we saw with Priti Patel, for example, which led to the resignation of Sir Alex Allen. So what needs to happen in order to protect Parliament and the ethics, if you like, around Parliament from a Prime Minister like Boris Johnson?
Well, could I just start by paying tribute to John, actually, for doing precisely, Alexis, what you said, which is when you feel that your position is untenable, you should resign. And John had the decency and the integrity and to do that, and he's an honourable man and did the honourable thing. What a contrast with the Prime Minister. But having said that, now I've probably put the kibosh on all of John's future career prospects as well. But that's what frenemies are for, I guess. But on the broader point that you make, Alexis, I think it's right that we've had this. I think the constitutional historian Peter Hennessy calls it the good chaps basis of government, whereby everybody just sort of rubs along. We don't have a written constitution. We don't have codified norms for behaviour, specific things that need to happen, independent agencies and institutions to make them happen. So everybody's just supposed to do the honourable thing. And that's why resignation is such an important part of the British uncodified constitution, precisely because we don't have a codified one. So when that starts to break down, when people stop behaving honourably, it really does raise profound questions about our democracy and about Parliament and about the way that our people should operate in public life. And that's why, I mean, my personal view is I think we need a full constitutional convention looking at every aspect of our constitution. I actually believe in proportional representation as well. I would reform our voting system. I would abolish the House of Lords. I would replace it with a democratically elected Senate drawn from all over the country. I would have an independent commissioner on integrity and ethics rather than this completely archaic system we have now. The whole thing is just, I'm afraid, belonging to a bygone era. And, you know, it does sometimes feel in Parliament like it's a sort of gentleman's club rather than actually a sort of serious place with serious rules and standards. So all of it needs to change. I would have I hope a Labour government would set up a constitutional convention, citizens' assemblies. I believe in deliberative democracy as well, bringing people into the conversation about the future of our democracy. So all of the stuff that's happening now, I'm afraid it's been coming for a long time. And the only thing that's held it together is we've, in the past, had prime ministers who had a basic level of honesty, honour and decency. Once you have a prime minister who doesn't have any of those things, the whole house of cards starts to tumble down.
Okay, I'm starting to get the feeling I might know who your villain of the week might be, Stephen. But let's proceed. We start with the villains of the week. I'm going to go to John first. John, who is your villain of the week this week?
I'm afraid I'm going to put my friendship with Stephen under stress here, because I'm going to nominate as my villain of the week is Nick Lynch, the guy who runs the RMT, who's going to be subjecting us all to 3 days of rail strikes next week.
Okay, well, we're going to be speaking to a representative of the RMT after the 2 o'clock news. I won't mention your villain of the week choice for them, John. Stephen, your villain of the week, please.
So my villain of the week is Sergei Lavrov. I don't know if you saw that interview with Steve Rosenberg. The level of deceit and...
The Russian foreign minister, we should say.
Yeah, the Russian foreign minister, yes, indeed. I mean, he's sort of become sort of Putin's right-hand man on the barbaric invasion of Ukraine. And I worry so much that there's a sort of Ukraine fatigue setting in and people moving on. But if you're looking for an example of pure evil, you just have to look at what's happening in Ukraine. And Lavrov is a sycophant and an enabler of Vladimir Putin, and so he's my villain of the week.
Okay, well, let's move to more pleasant pastures. Let's get your heroes of the week. John, you go first. Who's your hero of the week this week?
Well, the serious one has to be President Zelensky, but my slightly less serious one, and a bit more topical perhaps as well, is Kate Bush.
Ah, yes. And
because here she is with a number one, goodness, how many years since it was it
it's
first
37
came out,
years hill. Since it was first yeah. released, and she becomes the oldest person to hold a number one slot.
Yeah, absolutely amazing. And I'm just about old enough to remember I was at school when her songs were first hits. So it's just a pleasure to see it can still be done.
Yes, a very, very good choice. Stephen, your hero of the week, please.
That's a brilliant choice, actually, on Kate Bush. I'm a huge fan. I'm also a huge fan of Stranger Things, the Netflix series that has boosted it. My hero is it's a guy called Paul Lindley. So Paul is an entrepreneur. He set up a company called Ella's Kitchen, which yes. Makes healthy food mainly for children and babies, but has branched out into many other things. He has written an excellent piece in Times Red Box. So I'm giving the Times House another plug there.
Thank you very much.
Talking about why he's joined the Labour Party. And talking about why he believes the Labour Party is the party of business and of entrepreneurship and of workers. And it's so brave, I think. There's very few business leaders out there who are prepared to actually stick their necks out and say, here I am, I believe the Labour is the right party for us. And so kudos to Paul. It's an excellent piece that he's written and really exciting for me because I'm very committed and passionate to Labour being the party of business.
Well, look, thank you both so much. Great villains and heroes from both of you. Thank you very much, John. John Penrose, Conservative MP for Weston-super-Mare and former Northern Ireland Minister. And thank you to his political frenemy, Stephen Kinnock, of course, you heard from there, Labour MP and Shadow Minister for Immigration. Very much enjoyed hearing about your friendship and also hearing about your thoughts on the biggest stories of the week. After the news, we're going to be